Hi, and welcome to Insights from Cumberland County College. My name is Kevin McGarvey. My guest today is Congressman Frank LoBiondo. Congressman LoBiondo is running for his 11th term in the United States House of Representatives. New Jersey's 2nd District is an enormous one geographically, encompassing all or parts of 8 counties. In fact, it's nearly 40% of the state of New Jersey. The 2nd District is typically very loyal to its representative in Congress. We've had only 3 members in the 2nd District in the last half century: Charles Sandman from 1964 to 74, Bill Hughes Sr. from 1974 to 94, and Congressman LoBiondo from 1994 until the present. And it's a pleasure, sir, to welcome Congressman LoBiondo to the program.
Thanks, Kevin. Very happy to be here.
We have so many things to talk about. We have only 30 minutes. I have asked the college community to give me some questions, and I don't think you'll be surprised that the economy was the question that was submitted to me the most. I would like to do this, sir. You have been talking about creating and protecting jobs in South Jersey. We all know how important that is. Could you please talk about the region as a whole economically, and then we can focus in a little bit and talk about Atlantic City and then finally Cumberland County?
Sure. Well, the region as a whole is suffering. We don't need to read reports to understand that. We only have to talk to our friends and neighbors and understand how many people are struggling, how many people are out of work, how many of people have been moved from full-time jobs to part-time jobs, now have to work 3, 4, 5 jobs in some cases to be able to do this. So it's been a real challenge for many years, and it's a very big challenge now. Where do we go from here? How do we handle this at this point? Most of you know me. You know that I helped run our family business for more than 25 years. I'm a kid who grew up on a farm in Rosenhain, and I know what it's like to sign the front of a paycheck. I know what it's like to create those jobs. I know what it's like to fight government regulations and to be able to fight to retain jobs. So the federal government's role, as I see it, federal government does not create jobs. Federal government may be creating government jobs, but if we're talking here in South Jersey, we need to establish a climate where business, large or small, has the confidence that there's the stability and the certainty of them investing their money and their time and sweat equity. Mm-hmm. And right now, they don't have that. Right now, because of a variety of reasons, businesses feel that the structure is too uncertain. Obamacare is killing our small businesses. We have numerous examples where people aren't sure what the regulations are going to be. And I'll throw our farmers into that small business category, where the EPA is coming up with some crazy new ideas, regulating dust on farms and things like that, that are pushing farmers and their families out of the business. So I'm very proud once again this year, and it's been every year I've run, to be endorsed by the United States Chamber of Commerce mm-hmm. and the National Federation of Independent Businesses, because they're the ones from the real world who judge us on how we're voting and do our policies allow for the creation of jobs and the retention of jobs. So I've worked in partnerships to try to create jobs here in Cumberland County in South Jersey, and we've had a degree of success. We need to do a lot more. The Food Innovation Center in Bridgeton is a great example. Mm-hmm. Rutgers is the umbrella. Federal government's involved, state government's involved, county government's involved. And the idea of taking a farmer's product, which when you and I were growing up a few years ago, mm-hmm. if you grew eggplants, you either sold the eggplants or that was it. Now they have farmers who are taking the eggplants, and because of the Food Innovation Center, which is an incubator business center, state-of-the-art technology, they turn those eggplants into cutlets. They turn them into another product that can be frozen and then sold. Tremendously successful. They've got a European company that does gluten-free bread. They're big in Europe. They set them up as an incubator. They did so well, they're investing $60 million. They did, creating a bunch of new jobs here. Well, the Food Innovation Center is in Bridgeton, and the business actually was created a little bit outside of Bridgeton in Gloucester County. Mm-hmm. So I think these are the ideas that are going to move us forward, and it's working through these partnerships. What the college is doing with job retraining, understanding that there are skills that we have businesses that come that are concerned because they don't have a workforce. So the partnership is pretty all-encompassing. And again, it's the private sector, it's the educational community, it's the state, it's the county, and all of us coming together can produce results.
Mm-hmm. The unemployment rate in Cumberland County is right around 13-14%. In Atlantic City, it's higher. Atlantic City has been hit extremely hard in the last few months. What do you see for Atlantic City over the next year or two or three? What plans do you have to try to get Atlantic City back to work?
Well, Atlantic City is suffering devastating losses of casinos and people being put out of work. Mm-hmm. If you're one of these people that's losing your job, your life is devastated and you just want it fixed. A lot of people talk, well, how could this have happened? Happened for a variety of reasons. You have only to look across the river, what Pennsylvania's doing, what Maryland's doing. So a lot of our visitors to Atlantic City, Baltimore, Washington, Philadelphia, New York, all of these areas have been cannibalized by other casino jurisdictions, mm-hmm. which make it difficult. Couple that with a tough economy, and you've got a bad situation. State of New Jersey has total control over the regulation of the casinos. Mm-hmm. But how do we pull out of this now that we know we're in the problem? The partnerships that have been created and the initiative by Governor Christie and Senate President Sweeney to bring the stakeholders together with the mayor of Atlantic City, with the state legislators, with the unions, with the casino operators, and understand what we can do. Mm-hmm. Through new legislation a couple of years ago, we went from about 10% non-gaming revenue, dining, retail, entertainment, mm-hmm. to we're at about 25 to 30% now. We need to get to about 50%. So that transition has started, but turning it into more family-friendly, turning it into an entertainment destination, mm-hmm. and that's why I have hope for the people who are buying the Revel. First of all, they have a lot of business experience. Secondly, they have a very deep pocket.
So you're talking about rebranding Atlantic City again, rebranding it, turning it from a gambler's paradise into some sort of a real family destination.
I think that's what it's going to have to be. And again, I think this partnership that has come together will be part of what will help drive that. The difficulty is it's not fast and it's not easy. So hopefully there'll be federal components. And Senator Booker, Senator Menendez, and I have all pledged to be ready to move. I'm working with Senator Booker on the federal component that's available now, which is the emergency grants for the retraining dollars, which can help out in certain cases. In other cases, it could be transitions dollars. I've been working on the unemployment extension with the devastation that's happened in Atlantic City. We'll continue to work on that. So the pieces of the federal puzzle I'm doing my best with. And again, I think through the partnerships is where we'll get success.
We both grew up around here. We both lived around here for a long time. I think that one of the problems with Atlantic City is that the wealth has really always been very concentrated. You have the glittering casinos, mm-hmm. and then just a few blocks away you have extreme poverty. And even in the glory days of gambling, the poverty was in Atlantic City. It's a sad situation.
It is a sad situation. And for years, I guess, a lot of people thought the goose would never stop laying the golden eggs. And we see a number of casinos, especially the ones that have been in trouble, when they were making money, did not reinvest money back into the properties. So the properties that are doing well, and we have some that are doing very well, why are they doing so good and others are not able to make it? Mm-hmm. Well, look at the management style. Look at what they've put back into it. Look how fresh they've kept the property. Look at their own individual marketing where they didn't rely on someone else to do the marketing. Borgata is fabulously successful. You can see the fellow who's running Borgata. I've had people tell me, I'm not there at 1 o'clock in the morning, but I've had people tell me they're there at 1 o'clock in the morning and he's checking out the restrooms. He's seeing how customers are being treated. He's making sure that things are clean and spruced up. They're putting money back into their rooms. They're making it attractive. They're making it, you know, very vibrant. Mm-hmm. And the properties that didn't do that, and we're expecting just to keep making money, and an example is Showboat, a profitable property. So parent company, mm-hmm. Caesars Management, decides they're going to close a profitable property. I mean, first of all, that doesn't make any sense. And secondly, you know, the fact that it was making money was not good enough. It had to make more money. Mm-hmm. And Caesars is going to build a casino outside of New York that's going to be $700 or $800 million. These are the things that are eating us up alive.
We We need to move on to national mm-hmm. security. I have a question for you. You were in Africa recently, and why were you in Africa, and what did you learn there? We'll talk about ISIS in a few minutes, but what did mm-hmm. you learn in Africa?
Well, to back up for a minute, it was my second trip this year, my sixth trip overall. And I've had the tremendous honor of the last 4 years being on the House Intelligence Committee. Mm-hmm. So the House Intelligence Committee is responsible for overseeing the 16, authorizing and overseeing the 16 intelligence agencies that protect our country. It's the smallest committee in Congress, and as we review the authorizations and then the oversight of those authorizations, many questions occur that are of a critical nature to protect the country. When I was told I was going to have an opportunity to be on the committee, the speaker, House leadership, and especially the committee leadership said, look, we're going to be asking you to go to places to get information on the ground because we can't get a real good answer here in Washington for a variety of reasons. So everything I do on the committee is classified, and as we get sort of dribbles of information in Washington in a closed classified setting, it's important to verify if our policies are working, if they're not working, what should we be doing additionally, and is there stuff that we're missing that's not getting back to us. So what will end up happening is the chair will say, we've got serious questions in this part of the world. Could be Yemen. Could be related to the Syrian-Iranian problem. It could be related to all the problems in Africa. Here's where I need you to go, and this is what I need you to find out. The first trip this year was Nigeria, Niger, Mali, Mauritania, Burkina Faso, that part of the world, mm-hmm. Where terrorism, unfortunately, is on the upswing, Boko Haram specifically. This last trip was a result of what was happening in Somalia, and I was the first member of Congress to be allowed in Somalia in more than 20 years. And it was specifically to find out how Al-Shabaab is connecting to ISIL and connecting to Boko Haram and connecting to Khorasan, and what does that mean to the threat to our country?
Mm-hmm. Two or three months ago, I think most Americans hadn't even heard of ISIS or ISIL. How much of a threat is ISIS to us? Is it a great threat?
It's impossible to say just how serious a threat it is. It is serious beyond anyone's imagination. This is a group that the intelligence committees in the House and the Senate, we're very bipartisan, one area of Congress that is, if you didn't have a scorecard of knowing who was in what party, you would not be able to tell from the discussions. Senator Dianne Feinstein has been outstanding chairing the Senate committee. Mm-hmm. House committee has worked in a very bipartisan way, and we begged, House and Senate intelligence begged the president to do something about ISIL. A couple of years ago, we had some fabulous options. Could have been very effective, could have been, I don't want to say easy, nothing in this area is easy, but easier. President didn't want to get involved, ignored the advice of people like Leon Panetta and Dianne Feinstein. And now we find ourselves with very difficult options of how to deal with this. And the enormous capability has been developed because we seriously miscalculated their what would mean when they have an ability to make $2 to $4 million a day on the oil market, the black market. And they've used that money very intelligently from their standpoint. They now have a minister of finance, a minister of education, a minister of health, a minister of communication. I mean, they are a terrorist state. They're attracting the other terrorists. They're attracting the most radical and gruesome of the terrorists because of their tactics. They've got the money to spread around to do this, and their whole objective is to plant their flag here, to do damage to the United States, to kill Americans and blow stuff up in America. I am convinced if we don't deal with this problem there, we're going to have a much bigger problem, and it's going to be here.
We'll pick up on this in the second segment. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Larry Kane in the Cumberland Mall. All the best, everybody, at Cumberland County Community College. Your success begins there.
Welcome back to the second half of Insights. I'm Kevin McGarvey. My guest today is Congressman Frank LoBiondo. And Congressman, you recently stated that you are very concerned about radicalized American Muslims. You said that it's very scary, I'm quoting you, because it means that they hold U.S. passports and often British passports, and we have to be able to get a handle on this before they come back into our country. How much of a problem is this? This question of Americans who may go to the Middle East and come back radicalized to attack America?
I think it's an enormous problem. So these are people, young people, who have been radicalized in sort of the worst possible way. To be able to think that it is okay to join a group like ISIL and go along with all the gruesome tactics that they're employing, only some of which we hear about. They're Americans, they hold American passports, they volunteer to go over and join ISIL, be involved with everything horrible they're doing, and part of what we believe is happening is that they're receiving training while they're there with instructions to come back here, and that's where the scary part comes. So I think it's rather simple. I don't understand the hesitation on the part of the president that if you hold an American passport and you decide to go over and fight with ISIL, you don't come back here. No ifs, no ands, no buts. You want to put it to a vote of Congress? I think it'll be passed overwhelmingly. You don't want it to be put to a vote of Congress? Just decree that this is what it's going to be. You'll have all of America agreeing with this. So this is a big threat with them either sending their own people across our border to be embedded here to do what? Not because they like our hamburgers or hot dogs or our, you know, corn on the cob, because they want to do damage here. They want to kill Americans. They want to do something spectacular. So we have to understand this and deal with it in a strong way.
Let me present to you a nightmare scenario. We're both old enough to remember when President Johnson authorized what he called strategic air attacks on North Vietnam. He learned in a very short time that you need to have people on the ground to direct the planes. And within about 1 year's time, we had, 180,000 troops in North Vietnam. Within 2 years, we had 500,000 troops there. Do you see, is there any possibility at all that our involvement with ISIL and in Syria and in Turkey and in Iraq could expand to such a level where we get bogged down to the point where we were in Vietnam, say, in 1965, 66, 67?
No,
I don't. Is that possible at all?
I don't see that. I mean, look, anything is possible. We don't know. We had reports today that ISIL has stolen, confiscated Syrian jet fighters, and that they have former Iraqi officers who are teaching them how to fly these jets, and they have the ordnance. That's enormous. Now, I don't think they have the capabilities, so it's very difficult to predict, but in Vietnam, with all the bad decisions that were made, we really weren't talking about the kind of coalition that we're talking about here. The technology has changed dramatically. We didn't have all the GPS-guided ordnance that we have now. We didn't have drones. We didn't have all of the things that are at our disposal. But we're not putting spotters on the ground. They need to be effective. And the president promised the coalition would backfill the need to have soldiers on the ground to hold the ground that we take. The president's leadership and the United States' position of power has been seriously eroded because so many times, and I think everybody can start thinking about these times, the president has promised what the United States would do and then somewhere along the line abandoned that. So the people that we're expecting to join in with us on this fight, they're apprehensive we're going to leave them in a lurch. They're apprehensive that we're not going to follow up. President's saying it's different this time. And if he can convince the people, the Arabs who want to fight ISIL with us, the Kurds, the Peshmerga, a lot of these tribes that we had on our side for a while, and then we abandoned them, now we're trying to convince them to come back. If he's successful there, Then we'll have the people on the ground that we need, and they won't be our people, except for forward observers and those who are sort of gathering intelligence and things like that, mm-hmm. who are really not in harm's way the way a soldier would be in the way it was in Vietnam and the way it was in Iraq.
One of your colleagues, Representative Duncan Hunter from mm-hmm. California, was quoted the other day as saying that ISIL soldiers are coming across the Mexican border now, not in the future, but they're actually coming across the border. I think he said approximately 10 of them a day. Do you believe that?
I believe they're coming across the border. I don't know if I believe they're 10 a day.
Do you believe that the Mexican border is really the greatest threat for ISIL? Is that their
Mexican border is an enormous threat to the United States. The president, a couple of years ago, by executive order, directed that federal border agents not be allowed to patrol federal lands. This is insanity. There was, of course, nobody sort of brought it out. The president wasn't called down. He didn't have to explain it. So you now have this terrible tragedy with the unaccompanied kids that are coming across who want to find a border agent and say, I'm here, take me in, because they know we must. And then you've got the reverse. You've got the gang members, which we know are coming from Central America, which are a big problem for America, but a bigger problem are the terrorists. And they're coming across in federal lands that are unpatrolled. This is another nightmare scenario, because we don't know who it is that's coming across, but we do understand that these people are trained and equipped and determined to wreak havoc on us. So I am very concerned about this.
Thank you. In the 5 or 6 minutes we have left, I'd like to ask you some questions and perhaps relatively short answers. Is there any possible scenario in which you would support privatization of Social Security? It was suggested about a dozen years ago by members of your party. Is this something that you would ever consider?
No.
In any way?
No. Privatization cannot take place. And I was one of the Republicans who spoke up against Republican President George W. Bush when he first talked about this. Bad idea.
Okay. Extension of unemployment benefits. Mm-hmm. I had Mr. Hughes on the show a couple of weeks ago, and Mr. Hughes said that you have written a letter to Speaker Boehner in support of extending unemployment benefits, but that you refuse to sign what's called a discharge petition, which would force the speaker into an up or down vote about extending unemployment benefits. Mm-hmm. Clarify that, please.
Well, I'm a strong supporter of unemployment benefit extension. In fact, I'm one of a handful of Republicans in the House who is supporting it. Even sponsored legislation, along with a Senate colleague, identical legislation to do this. What Mr. Hughes is talking about, if I were to do that, it would have no effect. It's timed out. It's not relevant to the way these things are written. They have timelines in them and they have specifics that don't relate to what the situation is right now. Mm-hmm. We need to do this. Mm-hmm. It is critical. And our district is suffering, but a lot of other districts, my colleagues say, unemployment's coming down. National unemployment's in good shape. We're not hearing from our constituents. For our constituents, it's critical, and I'll continue to do everything I can to try to get this put into place.
Constituent services. What's a typical day like, or a typical week in the office of Congressman LoBiondo? What kind of work
do
you do?
Well, constituent services, probably the most critical part of what I do and the most rewarding. People who come to us with nightmares of their involvement and the lack of help from the federal government they should get, it's not talked about because of privacy issues. Once in a while, someone will talk about it. The veterans who come to us with nightmare horror stories, being able to untangle that for them, being able to solve those problems, it's enormous. I read every phone opinion every day, have for 20 years, spend hours every week calling people back. Mm-hmm. And constituent services for me is not just someone coming in to the office. It's me being at the church barbecue and the fire company breakfast and someone coming up to me and saying, I've been hoping to see you. I have a real problem. And me taking the information and us contacting them and getting the case started. And we've got a really good track record of solving those problems.
That must be enormously gratifying.
It is. Tremendous.
Do you believe in climate change, sir? Do you believe in man-made greenhouse gases causing environmental harm?
I think there is man-made climate change. How we solve it is a different problem. We have to make sure that whatever solution we have encompasses China and India and those countries, that if we do everything right and they do nothing, we have a problem. And how do we do what we're going to do without costing us more jobs? So we need to have a very vigorous debate on how we do this. And I'm very proud of my environmental endorsements by the League of Conservation Voters, the only Republican in the House of Representatives to be endorsed by them. They are the gold standard umbrella organization and the National Wildlife Federation.
How about minimum wage?
Supporter of minimum wage, have been, will be.
Supporter, what do you mean?
Voting for the minimum wage increase.
To?
Well, the numbers vary. So why do the numbers vary? The numbers vary because I think it should be in a package. It should be in a package with business, because inevitably, if we're not careful, just raising the minimum wage could cost some people a job, because small businesses can't make that up. I think it should be done. I think part of the discussion should be what tax incentive package, what incentives can we do with the Chamber of Commerce and the National Federation of Independent Businesses that would be able to raise the minimum wage and still help protect and create some new jobs. And I really think that's the answer to it.
Thank you. Congressman, we have 2 minutes left.
Right.
Why should the 2nd District elect Frank LoBiondo to his 11th term?
Well, most of you know me, you've seen me, you've known me for a long time. You knew me as your Cumberland County freeholder. You knew me as a representative in the New Jersey General Assembly and as a member of Congress. You've seen me at your church barbecues and your fire company breakfast. You know the passion that I bring to the job. You know how I desperately want results for the area. You know how I put my heart and soul into helping the constituents of the district. And I have a long list of accomplishments. Be happy to answer to anyone who wants to call. But what I think I've demonstrated is that I have the experience to get the results, and I have the passion to push to get those results. There are two things that I believe are essential to representing the district, and I believe that I've proven that year in and year out, and hope that you agree with me and humbly ask for your support and your vote once again this year.
Congressman LoBiondo, I wish you the very best of luck in the election.
Thank you.
My name is Kevin McGarvey. My guest today has been Congressman Frank LoBiondo. This is Insights from Cumberland County College, and we'll see you next time.